we have very different hills and very different types of hill farms, and a lot of it is dictated, I suppose, by the amount of green ground or improved ground you have. I suppose just because you have maybe a limit on the amount of green ground you have doesn't mean you can't have yours in good condition. So if I give an example from the Better Farm program, Kieran, within our flocks there, we have ewes that are ranging in average live weight from just over 40 kilos right up to ewes that are ranging in live weight nearly 55 kilos. Within that, we don't have the same range in body condition scores. So that flock of ewes that's down closer to 40 kilos is on a particularly hard hill, very little green ground, but the ewes are actually averaging in a good body condition score because they're a smaller, lighter type ewe to suit that system.
Hello, I'm Kieran Lynch, and welcome to OviCast, the Teagasc Sheep Podcast. Each episode, we'll bring you latest insights, advice, and technical updates for the sheep industry. We're joined this episode by Dr. Frank Campion as we discuss ewe condition and mate management in hill ewes. We start off with Frank discussing the impact of ewe condition on performance in hill flocks, and we discuss the targets, variation in ewe weight we see on the better farms. We move on discussing the sire mating and crossbreeding, and we finish up with Frank offering some tips on reducing the impact of farm infertility. We hear first from Frank as he discusses the importance of ewe condition.
It's slightly different from a hill flock. So I suppose the general thinking around it is that, you know, increased body condition score in a lowland flock will bring you up your litter size, which it will as far as the genetic potential is there. I suppose in a hill flock, you also want to increase the body condition score, but it's not litter size you're looking at. It's number of ewes in lamb. And when this has been looked at before by yourself and others and myself on the better farms using the hill flocks, we've seen that, you know, as we get flock body condition score up, and get up towards that optimum, what we see is rather than massively increasing litter size, which we don't want to do in a hill flock, what we're really just increasing is pregnancy rate. I suppose to give you a broad example of something like this, you know, if you took a 250 ewe hill flock that had an average body condition score of 2 and increased that up by a full unit up to 3, you'd have an extra 32 lambs on the ground. You know, and within a system where you're talking about weaning rates that are generally less than one lamb per ewe to the ram, you know, those extra few lambs is a big benefit to the system, but you're not massively increasing the number of twins within that flock.
No, when you're retaining ewes in the flock, you have less dry ewes and a bigger pick of replacements. It's achieving a hell of a lot. And that's without considering the impact on production the following year.
Exactly. So you're achieving a hell of a lot. More ewes and lambs, more lambs to sell. But as you said, then there's the carry over to the following year. And we've looked at this with flocks that probably have a below optimum body condition score, what we can see is that can actually build year on year if it's not addressed. So you have a lot of tin ewes running the flock, you have poor pregnancy rates. If you don't address that, what actually happens is you get into a consistent cycle of having tin ewes, and that builds up other problems then in terms of flock health problems. You know, ewes not being able to go to the hill and stay on the hill for as long and perform on the hill the way we want them to. And then that leads to farther reaching problems in terms of getting enough replacements retained in the flock, etc.
Well, just briefly, Frank, just outline the targets for me at mating for hill flock, and we'll discuss it in a bit more detail then.
So, yeah, our target for a hill flock, Kieran, is an average body score of 3 going to the ram. But I suppose the average is always a dangerous figure, and particularly so a body condition score, because it can make a bad flock look good or a good flock look bad, vice versa. So what we really should be looking at is having as few as yours as possible in less than body score 2.5. You know, that's as thin as you want them going to the ram. You know, any less than that at 2.5, they have very little reserves on for a winter on the hill, but they've also very little reserves on for post lambing when they actually need the reserves to produce milk for the lambs. So, you know, for the way I'd be looking at this is when you're looking at the hill you're going to the ram is a few ewes less than 2.5, and ewes that are 2.5, then you're investigating what's going on there. Is there an issue with mouths? Is there a flock health issue? You know, should they even go to the ram where they're significantly less than that? And where they have gone to the ram in that sort of condition, they're the sort of ewes then that you need to be looking at. Maybe need an extra bit of attention during the winter months and in the run-up to lambing. They mightn't be fit to go back to the hill. They might need that extra bit of feeding in the run-up to lambing.
I think all of what you cover is relevant to it. I suppose the way I always look at condition score, in some ways, you're saving here. It's like money in the bank. So it's that reserve you can carry in for all the scenarios you outlined. But it is probably something we need to focus a lot more on. I'm going to show something different here. We have a lot of different type of hills down there, a lot of different access to greenland, different quality hills. Talk to me a little bit about the impact that has, and maybe just the relationship between condition score and that mature ewe weight.
You're right. We have very different hills and very different types of hill farms, and a lot of it is dictated, I suppose, by the amount of green ground or improved ground you have. And I suppose just because you have maybe a limit on the amount of green ground you have doesn't mean you can't have yours in good condition. So if I give an example from the Better Farm program, Kieran, you know, within our flocks there, we have ewes that are ranging in average live weight from just over 40 kilos right up to ewes that are ranging in live weight nearly 55 kilos. But within that, we don't have the same range in body condition scores. So that flock of ewes that's down closer to 40 kilos is on a particularly hard hill, very little green ground, but the ewes are actually averaging in a good body condition score because there's a smaller, lighter type ewe to suit that system. Equally, then when we move towards our slightly heavier type ewe, it's probably not as a it's not a, as tough a hill, for want of a better way of putting it. There's a bit more access to green ground, so if you're slightly bigger ewe, but we have a very similar body condition score again, because the condition score is on relative to the type of ewe that it is, you know. And that's the beauty of condition score, and that's why we tend to talk about condition score with sheep as more than lightweight. Apart from the fact that it's a much easier thing to go out and do, all you need is your hands, but also the fact that it allows for a bigger type ewe versus a smaller type ewe. You're just assessing muscle reserves and body fat reserves.
So there is a little bit there of a ewe to suit the system, not the system to suit the ewe in the hill context. So yeah, we'll have that variation in mature ewe weight, but you can still hit the condition score with them.
Exactly. So you like I said, we've a 15 kilo variation in live weight across the better farm flocks this year, but on our averages, our condition scores are only within half a condition score of each other. And equally, we have a flock down there with a 45 kilo average weight. There's only 6% of the ewes are less than body score 2.5. You know, so that's a ewe to suit that system. It's been managed well over a number of years now, and they have a ewe that's able to hold condition at a lighter live weight and suit the type of hill and the type of ground that's available.
Frank, just when we're talking about the weight of them, some of them flocks are a lower live weight. In terms of their hoggets coming into that system, the suitability for breeding, and maybe the emphasis placed on managing hogget replacements.
Yeah, and this is a story that applies to lowland and upland and hill, no matter what way you define your system is. You know, I suppose those hoggets need to be 80% of their mature weight when they're lambing down for the first time. We're going to the ram for the first time, I should say. So, you know, in order to get those targets, it can seem a long way off, particularly when you're talking about breeding a hogget. But you know, they kind of have to be managed the whole way along. And the temptation is that the added dry hoggets are grand. We let them off there and over here, and they're kind of put out of the way. But what we've seen over the years with this is that the flocks where we tend to struggle with getting condition score right is the flocks where we don't give enough attention to the hogget ewes or the ewe lambs. And that's because they can often start off below the target in terms of weight and in terms of condition score. They then find their first lactation and first lambing period much more difficult. And then it's a harder thing to put that condition and weight back onto them again during their first dry summer after their first crop of lambs. And that's a carryover effect and can carry through the flock. So for a lot of flocks, you know, your replacement rate is going to be somewhere between 20 or 25%, or that's what it should be. So if your hoggets are underweight or under condition coming in, and then as a result, your second crop ewes lambing down or slightly behind because they were behind at the start, it's a huge chunk of the flock that are already behind in condition before you ever start addressing any other issues.
Look, we're talking 25% every time, as you said, they are worth paying attention to.
It doesn't need to be, it's not, we're not saying go out and start pumping your lambs with feed or anything like that. It's just getting the basics right, making sure they've got their health treatments in terms of fluke dose and et cetera is done correctly, making sure there's no lameness issue. And then it's just making sure that they're not basically held up on a very bare patch for the whole winter and not thought about again until next summer, until we're looking at what's going to the ram again.
So if the bit of supplement needs to go in or training the mineral meal needs to go in, yeah, that first winter is going to have an impact on it. Let's move on a little to mating. Look, you talked a little bit about the range you've seen on the better farms. Talk to me a little bit about the mating management on them and what's happening this year with them.
Yeah, so look at mate management, like with everything, will differ a bit between flocks, but I suppose for most hill flocks, they do like to do some single sire mating. Most of the flocks are closed flocks at this stage, you know, and as the most hill flocks will be because they're hefted to certain parts of the hill. So you're trying to breed your own replacements. There'll be certain rams bought with the idea that you want replacements off them. So there'll be a good bit of single sire mating going on. The caveat or the warning with that is, yes, that's fine, and there's a benefit to it. You really have to be good at your mating management then. So for in terms of rattle or putting on the marking harness, those colours will have to be changed ideally every week, but at the very least after 2 weeks. And then it's about swapping over rams after 17 days. So the reproductive cycle of the sheep is 17 days. So after the first 17 days, swap over rams or even introduce kind of a sweeper ram. So for some of the lads, what they'll do is they might have a lowland kind of terminal ram like a Texel or something that will go in behind after the first 2 weeks, and that'll clean up any of the repeats or anything else. And it just makes sure then that if a ram is, infertile or subfertile, and it's not working properly, that you're not ending up with a lot of MTOs come next January or February when you're pregnancy scanning. I suppose the other side of that then, Kieran, is crossbreeding. And I suppose a question that often comes up for hill flocks in terms of mate management, and this is very much flock dependent, and it depends on what their weaning rate is. So, the lower the weaning rate, the less option there is or potential there is for crossbreeding. And the higher the weaning rate, the more crossbreeding can be done, to put it very simply. And I suppose, at least, if you're down around a weaning rate of 0.8, 0.85, you're going to need at least 60 to 70% of the flock going back to a hill ram so that you have enough replacements. And then as you get back up towards the target for most of these flocks will be to have one lamb per ewe joined. They can come back down to maybe half the ewes getting a crossbreed and half the ewes going back to pure breeding. But for most of our flocks, what we'd find is the crossbreeding comes up to about 40%, and then after that, it's generally all pure breeding again.
Local idea of the sweeper as well, I suppose, is picking up them tail end ewes that you probably don't want replacement from anyway, if the ones are repeating or that, if it's fertility issues, or maybe some of them ewes are in poor nick. So it probably ticks a certain box from that point of view as well.
Well, it does look at, like, ideally all your replacements come from that first cycle, from that first couple of weeks of lambing, and it puts a very definite breaker in it at lambing time, that once you start getting into the crossbred lambs after 2, 2.5 weeks of lambing, you've no more replacements coming from that. Also your later lambs. So we know from all the research done here is that those crossbred lambs will be something around 3 kilos to 4 kilos heavier weaning time potentially. So if they're those couple of weeks later born, it just gives them that extra bit of weight advantage when it comes to selling time then in August, September, particularly where you're going for a store trade. And as you said, your better quality ewes are the ones that have held and reared that purebred ram in the first week or two, and there's where your replacements should come from. And I suppose it's one of those things, Kieran, that everyone thinks it's grand until something goes wrong. And we've had that example on the better farms a couple of times over the years, where little things have went wrong at mating, and suddenly you can end up with a below par scan in February, and you're looking back to it. And often what happens when we look back at this and is that we see basically, we weren't maybe quick enough to collapse the mating growth. We said, look it, we'll leave the ram in until 21 days or 22 days, and suddenly you have a whole pile of repeats that you didn't know about, but the ram that's after tipping them down the repeat is the same ram, and there's some issue there, so they're going to come around again outside of the mating window. Little things like that. So you do have to be very strict on it and very careful on it. And that extra bit of work now will give you the benefit then come next April.
Look, Frank, thanks for coming on with that update today. Look, it is useful. I think some of the tips you highlighted there are well worth putting into practice.
No problem, Kieran.
We'll leave it there for this week's episode. Updates on our sheep program, and keep an eye on our Twitter page at Chago Sheep. I'm Kieran Lynch. Thanks for joining us. Don't forget to subscribe and follow us for more episodes.